if you're diagnosed with the same type of cancer as someone else, your treatment plan is going to be the same as them, right? Not necessarily. Today, I'm going to be talking with Amy, who is also a stage 3 rectal cancer survivor, but her treatment plan differed a little bit from mine. In this video, we're going to talk about what those differences are, including stoma irrigation. For any of you out there that are new, my name is Jelena, and I was diagnosed with stage 3 rectal cancer back in 2016 when I was just 34 years old. I had no family history and no risk factors, so my diagnosis was a shock for sure. Now let's talk with Amy and hear her story.
All right, welcome, Amy. Thank you so much for joining me today to talk about your experience going through a cancer diagnosis and what treatment was like. So before we get too much into the nitty-gritty of what treatment was like, can you tell us a little bit about yourself before cancer?
Absolutely. And thanks for having me on your channel today, Jelena. I really appreciate it. And I'm so excited to be here. I was 41 when I was diagnosed. I'm a wife, a stepmom. I'm a dog mom. I'm a lover of travel, a big runner. I have a big aspiration to run a race across the United States in every state. And I've been working on that. But unfortunately, due to COVID and the cancer diagnosis, those hopes got put on the back burner. But I'm still chipping away at it. I know I mentioned I love to travel, particularly cruises, also another thing due to COVID that I haven't been able to enjoy, but definitely looking forward to getting back out there and doing some traveling.
Cool. So now we'll jump into your cancer story. So did you experience any symptoms before your diagnosis? And if you did, like how long was it from those first symptoms until you were diagnosed?
I did notice symptoms, and I think that's really what started everything for me. So to go back in January of 2020, I decided to change my diet. I actually transitioned from eating meat to following like more of a plant-based diet, and I started working out with a trainer. And I was so tired all the time. Like, I didn't know what it was, but I felt like I didn't have enough energy to get through the workouts. And I told my husband and the trainer, and they were like, you know, you're working long days and then you're going to the gym at night. Like, maybe, you know, you just need to try to get some more rest on the weekends. So I toughed it out and tried to get through the workouts from January to July. And then in July, I noticed that all of a sudden I started having like a lot of like digestive issues, from having abdominal pain and swelling and bloating to I started passing gas. And that was like not a normal thing for me at all. So I'm thinking, okay, this is really weird. Still didn't really do anything, just kept going through the workouts. Like, we're a few months into COVID now. And then literally I had to have a bowel movement, and I went and I had this bowel movement, and I looked down and literally saw a crime scene in my toilet, freaked out. And I was like, okay, this is not normal. So I decided I needed to do something. I basically went down the Google rabbit hole. Okay. Like, let's be honest, I'm just going to admit to it. So I started Googling stuff, and I also knew that I had a family history that included colon cancer, and I had family history of family members having hemorrhoids and colon polyps. So I was thinking that it was going to be one of those things. So I found a colorectal specialist and I made an appointment in July, and I went and saw him, and basically I told him about my family history right from the get-go, and that I was 41, and he, you know, entered all that information and did an exam and told me that I had a thrombosed hemorrhoid, and that basically where that was, that he couldn't really do anything, and that I should just go home and eat more fiber and drink more water. And I said, well, doc, like with my family history, I'm 41 and all, I know a lot of people are having colonoscopies at like 50, but could I get one? And he's like, well, you know, you're kind of young and I'm not really going to find anything. So I took his, you know, word, because, you know, he's the expert. And I went home and I thought, okay, maybe this was just a fluke. I'll just step up the protocol and what I'm doing. And from there, Basically nothing happened for 3 weeks, which that's not that long of a period of time, but exactly 3 weeks later, I had another serious full out murder crime scene in my toilet, totally wigged out. And I grabbed my camera and I started taking pictures. I called my husband. I was literally freaking out, inconsolable. I'm like, I have to get back and see this doctor again. I called them in the morning. They got me in within a few days. And this time I had the photos. I felt like I was more armed with, like, can we really do something? And, you know, he looked at them. He talked to me again and he did another exam. And he's like, you know what? The thrombosed hemorrhoid just bled. It probably like punctured itself and it just bled in the toilet. And, you know, that scares people. It's dramatic when you see that. So he's like, listen, I'm still happy to schedule the colonoscopy, but again, I'm not going to find anything. And with your age, you're probably going to want to check with your insurance company. I work for state government, so I wasn't concerned about that. I knew I had really good insurance. So I left his office and we basically had a little bit of conflicts with our schedule, but I got on the calendar for September, the middle of September. So maybe like 4 weeks that I was in fact going to have the colonoscopy. So I left and there was no, like for a whole month, there was no more episodes in the toilet, nothing like that. In fact, what was really alarming and troubling to me was I was talking to my husband and I thought maybe I should just cancel this appointment. It seems like the doctor was right, you know, that hemorrhoid probably just burst. But something in me with my family history said, no, it's probably like a polyp or something that needed to be removed. So September rolled around and I had that colonoscopy and it was almost a whirlwind of a blur that the second week in September when that happened, because when I woke up from that colonoscopy, I kind of felt like what happened from that moment played a factor in all the rest of my treatment and kind of why I'm here today is, I basically, woke up and the doctor was like, I found a lesion. And I looked at my husband and trying to come out of sedation. And I was like, a lesion. I was expecting hemorrhoid, polyp, like words. I knew what they meant. I didn't know what a lesion was. And he said, his office was going to call me in a few days and that I would be scheduled for a lot of appointments over the next 2 weeks and kind of to stay by the phone. I was really bewildered by all of that. And I was just super confused. So that was a Friday. My husband and I went home and we had what we recall as the longest weekend of our life, literally, because we spent it on Google and confused. And when Monday morning rolled around, the hospital called me and I found out that I was assigned a nurse navigator. And that lady basically told me that she was going to start the process for setting up a bunch of appointments for me. And when she was all done giving me that information, I said, can I just ask you a real quick question? Because I'm really confused. And she's like, sure. And I said, like, what's going on? And, you know, like, I'm really freaking out here. And she said, well, I can basically tell you that based on your doctor, your surgeon's experience, he is pretty sure that you have rectal cancer, but what's going to happen from here is going to be the staging process. And you just kind of have to hold tight for a couple of weeks until we know more and the biopsy comes back.
It's really weird. Did they ever mention the word cancer at all in those first few days?
So I never heard cancer in those first few days or the two office visits prior. It was really the word I heard the most was hemorrhoid and being too young, unfortunately. And then lesion was really thrown around a lot too. And when I went home and tried to find out a little bit more information about that, I was confused. But what I had forgot to mention was the fact that after he said lesion and we left that office, I was handed the printout that has your images and has like narrative language about what they found. And on that, on the second page, it actually said a 3-centimeter malignant tumor. And just looking at those words and kind of knowing what the word malignant and tumor meant, it was kind of like a huge like light bulb going off on the paper for me that I'm thinking, I think the doctor didn't want to say it to me, but the paperwork is telling me that I have cancer, but I need to wait for the biopsy to come back.
So how long did it take to get that biopsy? And then what was your ultimate official diagnosis?
Ultimately, it came out on the 24th, and that basically told them that I had rectal cancer. And that from there, I would be waiting to go through what, as you and a lot of people know, is the staging process, which involved me having more tests and scans to determine what stage I was and then kind of go from there.
Okay. So then what stage did you end up being diagnosed?
So after the CT scan and the MRI and the endorectal ultrasound that they did and the blood work for the CEA level, they came back and told me that I was a stage 3 rectal cancer diagnosis. I think like the medical term they use is like T3N1.
We had the same diagnosis. I was also a stage 3 rectal cancer patient, but your treatment plan differed a bit from mine. So for anyone that's watching that might be a little unfamiliar with what my story is, I started out doing 28 days of radiation and oral chemotherapy. Took a little break, went in for a lower anterior resection, which is a type of surgery. And then I had 8 rounds of the IV chemotherapy FOLFOX. And then after that was finished, I had my ileostomy reversed. So can you talk to us a little bit about how your treatment plan looked like and kind of those minor but major differences in how you went through treatment?
Absolutely. So my treatment plan, the doctors essentially, after I got that official diagnosis and I met with my team, I was essentially assigned a team. I didn't mention that. At my hospital, and it seems like a lot of other ones do it too, I was referred to what's called a multidisciplinary clinic. And then that included like the radiation oncologist, the oncologist that would do the chemo portion, and then a surgeon or surgeons that kind of come together with, I think even pathology that reads it. And they kind of also speak with whatever the American Cancer Society is recommending at the time as known as like the standard of care. And at my time, in watching your videos, our treatment plans essentially followed the same course, but within each phase of my treatment plan, there was the ability to like deviate and have different steps and do different little things inside of it. So after I met with that team in, now it's October 2020, basically they let me bring one other person because of COVID, and that was my husband. And it was so that you could have that support system to hear all that ever-changing information and process it and, you know, be able to ask questions and whatnot. Was what they were recommending for me was that step one would be 28 days of an oral chemotherapy, which was the capecitabine or Xeloda with the radiation, followed by phase 2 would be a surgical component. That was kind of up in the air at the time, but it would be some sort of surgery. And then phase 3 would be more chemotherapy. For me, that was an IV component, and I elected to do an oral pill with that. And that was, I did the capecitabine Xeloda again, and the IV component was oxaliplatin. And what they had recommended time for my stage was 3 months of this phase 3, which would be week on, week off. So 7 days on, 7 days off. With the first day of that week, I would, after I took the pill, I would go to the infusion center and have the infusion. I chose in my phase to not get a port placed because my team shared with me that if I wanted to try and use peripheral veins in my arms, they would attempt to alternate every other week left and right and see if my arms could take it. And knowing what I know now, I'm not sure that I would recommend it, but I did get through it. It was six rounds. So six times of beating those arms up, because the veins are quite a bit smaller than I think when you get the port placed. But that was a big difference. So I did that for phase three. And then phase four included another surgical component, which would have been reversal of my ileostomy, which I can thank my chemo brain for saying that I totally forgot to say that with my first surgery, I had a ileostomy created.
I think I forgot to mention that as well when I was describing my treatment plan. So that's all right. So you followed that initial plan, but then you also sought out a second and a third opinion. So how did you go about doing that, and what caused you to go out and seek those additional opinions?
So I decided to seek out additional opinions largely in part because of how I was first treated by that first colorectal doctor that I went and saw. I just felt like there was some sort of like miscommunication. We weren't like speaking the same language, yet we needed to speak this really bad language called cancer to one another. And, you know, whether it was some of his style and whether it was what I was hearing or what I was asking, I didn't feel that I was in the right care. I felt like I needed to speak to another surgeon as it related to the findings and kind of try to understand how a tumor was kind of initially really just thought to be, you know, a hemorrhoid, and maybe just getting another surgical opinion. I can say again, brain catching up with me later, is the fact that when I got my diagnosis, I was told that my tumor was a low-lying tumor, and my original colorectal doctor wasn't really confident in telling me that he would be able to prevent me from needing a permanent colostomy. And that was kind of troubling for me, knowing that that individual first thought I only had a hemorrhoid, and now they were telling me that I may end up with something permanently for the rest of my life. It just didn't sit real well with me. So I felt like I needed to get other surgical opinions, which I got in Michigan. And I also elected to do research and search for out of state as well.
You sought out these additional opinions. So how did you decide to switch surgeons and have your surgery outside of that initial group of your team?
So that decision came because after phase one of treatment, there's a lapse in time where the patient is kind of told that they have this ample time to recover and let the body heal, because what we learned through the process is that the radiation continues to work in the body after those 28 days or 5.5 weeks. Ultimately, you know, they're hoping, or for viewers that don't know, the tumor is going to hopefully continue to shrink if all the mapping and all that was done well enough. So during that time, I started to realize that, hey, you know, I had done the other research in regards to selecting the order that I wanted the treatment plan to be. Maybe now was the time to see what other surgeons I could find. And I, again, here I go, admitting it, you know, went down the biggest Google rabbit hole I've ever went down in my life, and was across the United States. Maybe it was an excuse to get out there and try to do a run in one of those states that I hadn't checked off my map. But ultimately, I landed somewhere not too far from home. And basically, you know, I read and saw information online that seemed a little more cutting edge, had more of a minimally invasive approach to it. And it included you know, information and links in regards to things for individuals that had low-lying tumors and the ability to have sphincter preservation and not need a permanent colostomy bag. So that some of that information, actually all of that information, was not discussed during that board meeting when they kind of told me, you know, everything about my case and their recommendations for me. And honestly, maybe I didn't think to ask some of those questions, but what I ended up learning was, hey, maybe they're not doing it in my backyard, but if they're doing it somewhere else and that's an option, again, this is a really big deal. Like, this is our bodies. This is our health. This is our lives. How can I not, you know, find out everything and then make a decision? So we basically scheduled an appointment, got in the car and drove to basically meet and speak with the surgeon at the end of December of 2020. So I was only about 2 weeks out of completing that first phase. So I was in that heal time window, and I met with that surgeon and his team, kind of explained everything. He had gotten my images from back home, and you know, the meeting and the dynamic was different right from the get-go, and having that comparison was so profound that it was one of those things like, what I know now, I can't unknow what I just found out. So between his bedside manner to how everything was laid out in a manner that I would understand, to the fact that he told me that I did qualify for the style of surgery they're doing, which I guess I didn't say as much about this in an earlier question. One of the differences about our treatment plans, well, the same, you having an LAR surgery, my surgery is referred to as a TATME, and that stands for a transanal total mesorectal excision. And it has with a laparoscopic approach. And essentially what that means, what this particular surgeon is doing, and treating other surgeons across the United States to do, I'm part of a clinical trial, is this minimally invasive approach where they're trying to save more people's sphincters when maybe they didn't think they could before, by doing sort of like a two-part surgery. So they went in laparoscopically. Like, I have four different incisions that kind of go in a circular fashion around my belly button, like 12 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 6 o'clock, 9 o'clock. They did their tiny little laparoscopic incisions so they could put their tools in there, as well as they do the part of the surgery is a transanal approach. They also go in essentially through your anus and go in and are able to dissect the part of the colon that needs dissecting by accessing you, kind of, for lack of better words, through multiple orifices. And then they're able to kind of have like a clean field that they can see more or less all the way through you. And I think that gives them the ability to know how much they actually have to work with when they're talking about saving people and being able to put them back together when they have these really low lying tumors. They're able to do that better.
Okay. And then the part that they remove, like of your colon and rectum, that comes out anally, correct? You didn't have a large incision where they removed that.
That is correct. So yes.
Another pro, because the recovery time is probably a little faster, or at least the pain might be a little less than LAR surgery, where you've got the large incision down your abdomen where they kind of open you up and remove things that way.
Absolutely. So yeah, I mean, talk about full disclosure. So essentially, yeah, the resected part of your colon, which in my case was a little over a foot, I mean, somewhere between a foot and a foot and a half with 14 lymph nodes, was essentially dissected and then all pulled and removed through your anus. And then from there, they are essentially, after that resected site, they're pulling the remaining part of your colon down to basically make you a new rectum. Because anyone from I guess people I've talked to, or at least with yourself, when you have rectal cancer, they're taking your whole rectum, and usually they're taking most, if not all, of your sigmoid colon, which is all part of right before your holding tank of that rectum. And they're pulling down that next part of the colon, which is the descending colon, and they're attaching that. And that's how they're essentially making you a new rectum, which will be like your new storage tank. So in my surgery, they also referred to that as like being hand sewn. I guess some people have that area stapled also. I don't know exactly what that entails, but they referred to mine as being what's called a hand sewn anastomosis. And that just means that after the resected site and what they pull down, they sew it back together delicately. And that is part of the reason also why rectal cancer patients end up like always with an ileostomy, because that resected site is so fragile and delicate, and it needs time to heal and not have that fecal matter pass through it. So in order for that to happen, they then create the ileostomy, and then you let that site heal and have the ileostomy for a period of time.
So then after you went through your IV chemotherapy and you were kind of preparing to get that ileostomy reversed, you had some special instructions to help prepare you for that reversal surgery. So can you talk to us about the irrigation that you did, and if you think that helped your bowels kind of adjust better or faster after you had that reversal surgery?
Absolutely. So yeah, this surgeon's office is also a fan of doing irrigation. And that's another thing to note about the differences in our treatment plans, yet while the same, is that with the irrigation component, I kind of knew I would be doing it from the get-go. It basically involved getting a bladder tank, which for anybody out there that likes hiking and knows what it's like to have like a camelback on your back or something like that, you get, and I actually have it here with me today to show people that may have not seen one, through your ostomy supply company. You get a prescription essentially for this bladder tank, which has the various markers on it. And it has this nice long hose and a clamp. And at the end is a funnel. This is a not used one, got multiple from the insurance company. So, you know, while I'm playing with it, essentially what I was told was that I would be doing irrigation before my ostomy would be reversed, because it would essentially help wake the colon back up, and it would get you to practice using that sphincter muscle again on the toilet. So with the help of my husband, I'm sitting on the toilet essentially, right? And having assistance is great. You would just fill the top of the pouch to 500 ml. So really the lowest line on here, you can see how high it goes. That would be way too much water to push through your colon, but you just fill it up with water. And then it's so far hanging above you, maybe, I don't know, a couple inches. And you then would put a lubricating jelly like on the tip of the top of the funnel. And then from there I use gloves, you know, it just felt better, but I would use gloves, and then I would put a little bit of that lubricating jelly on my finger. And before inserting this into your stoma hole, so yes, newsflash, you are gonna be putting this in your stoma hole, the lower hole, okay? I would have the lubricating jelly on my finger, and I would first push it gently into my stoma hole just to kind of like loosen it up and tell it that something else is coming in it. And then after that, I would just gently insert it into the bottom stoma hole, just a little ways. It doesn't need to go far. And then my husband would just maneuver the clamp, which would control an on and off switch of how much or how little or how fast you basically push the water through the stoma hole. You can do it over like 5 to 10 minutes, because you're going to instantly feel it in your abdominal area. And, you know, it's okay to pause the clamp and the rush of fluid so that you feel comfortable doing it. And then once all that water is in and you're satisfied, you can kind of close the door to the bathroom and you can just kind of wait. What I was told initially is that the first time a person does it, your body, your colon can absorb all that water, right? Because it's not used to what's going on. Like, this is a new thing. Like, I can't lie. I was terrified the first time to do it. Like, I was like, I'm going to be pushing water through my stoma hole and then it's going to come out my bum. Like, are you kidding me? Like, really? So, and then when they said that it could, that my body could absorb it, I was like, well, I hope my body doesn't do that, but if it does it, that's okay. So, I'm happy to report the first time was a success and my body did not absorb it. We went through, we did everything as I just explained, and you just kind of wait patiently. Everybody's body's different, but really within a minute, I could literally feel moving around in my insides to literally something feeling like a rush of fluid dropped into what I would describe was probably my new rectum, this new area, this new holding tank that is going to feel very sensitive at first, right? Because nothing's been in there for ever how long it is until your doctor tells you to first do this irrigation. So I did my first irrigation about 3 months after I received my ileostomy. So it was 3 months of not doing anything, just having the ileostomy. So then you basically wait to expel that water, which it can take anywhere from 15 minutes to an hour. Everybody's body is different. So when you do it, you need to be prepared that you might be sitting on the toilet for a while. Just like my body not absorbing the water, that first time within 30 minutes, all of the water expelled out of me, along with some mucus and some other stuff, because even though you're not using your colon per se, it's still functioning inside of you and it's still like congeals and there's mucus and there's things in there. So by you doing it, you're going to flush that out and kind of retrain and wake everything up. So it was like a surreal, bittersweet moment from going to like, you know, you have a hemorrhoid to you may need a permanent ostomy to saving your sphincter muscle to being on the toilet. Like, I'm sure, like for your case and other people, that first poo is a really big deal. Well, that I had that on my toilet before it was reversed. And it was like, okay, it's water, but like it's working. And I could pause and even practice holding it. So I knew right then and there that everything that was told to me from that second or third surgical opinion was evidence right there on the toilet that, hey, it was really working. And literally I didn't cry, but I was like elated.
How often did you irrigate? Was it a daily thing or like every week? How often did they recommend you do that?
So I did a total of 12 irrigations and I wasn't really given a set schedule. I think they wanted me maybe to do 2 a week, but it was when it was convenient for me. Obviously, you had to allot time to be in the bathroom a little bit longer and just also listening to how my body felt, because still flushing through that water, it does give you some abdominal discomfort and it's not the most pleasurable thing, but it's definitely tolerable and doing it is for, you know, a good reason, a good purpose. So, the tiny bit of uncomfortableness is worth it.
Okay.
All in all, okay. I did my last one the day before my reversal surgery was, they wanted me to do it one more time the night before the surgery.
All right. So then when did you have your reversal surgery? Kind of how long has it been? And do you think that irrigating really helped out with your control and how things have turned out since then?
I do. I had my reversal on September 9th, 2021, and I had the colon surgery, the colon resection in March of 2021. So I ended up having my ileostomy for 6 months, and I definitely think doing the irrigation for months 3 through 6 definitely played a factor in, you know, it gave me peace of mind where, you know, you don't know what's going to happen. And, you know, I think for anybody that's waiting to find out, like, hey, even if somebody says, we're going to be able to reverse you and this isn't going to be permanent. Like, I have to think that people are still waiting for that day to come to know that, okay, they really did. In fact, they were able to reverse me. So seeing that the irrigation helped with control and that everything was working and what it felt like to have stuff inside of me, for lack of better words, like to have things going through the colon since everything was being routed through the ileostomy, it was like a surreal, nice feeling to feel like normal again, right? To actually like have a bowel movement on the toilet than just outside of a bag. Like, so that peace of mind was really good.
As you mentioned, you're in Michigan, I'm in Colorado. So we obviously didn't meet in person. So do you want to share the story of how we ended up meeting?
I sure do. So we met basically because I was on a mission to find information out from the get-go when it started with, hey, what is this diagnosis? What does this mean? What is it going to look like for me? And that meant not just Google, but I hopped onto YouTube and I just started putting in a bunch of various searches. I'm not a social media person. I don't have a social media platform or really do any of that. My husband, has like, is on YouTube, and essentially we were just thumbing through stuff and doing random searches and putting things in about rectal cancer and survivors and how I could find out information of what my path could look like or could be different. And I literally stumbled on Survivor Jelena and found these videos to be a breath of fresh air, for lack of better words. Like, literally, I felt like I found somebody that I knew had the same diagnosis as me and had walked this path, that somebody was pushing me on this path, this like scary path that there's all this, you know, eerie stuff to the left and right that I don't want to be on. And I have this like mentor, for lack of better words, that's giving me things that they experienced. And I felt like on top of what I needed to know about kind of getting off to a bad start with how I found out that I had cancer, was a relief to know that there was this cancer community and it didn't matter that we weren't in the same state. So I started watching your videos, and I basically, you know, from you sharing where you were at and things you were involved with, had also seen the organization Fight CRC, Fight Colorectal Cancer, to which I had stumbled on them on Google searches myself because I wanted, you know, advocacy groups as well. And I actually decided right from the get-go that I wanted to not only fight this fight, but that I also wanted to give back while I was fighting. And I basically messaged them to see how I could do a volunteer, you know, at a very minimal level while going through treatment. And they told me about this gratitude program that they have. And they basically told me that, you know, if I felt like helping them out, I could essentially write postcards to people and thank them for, you know, donations and contributions that they help fight CRC in all of the advocacy work and information that they get out to people so that they can be educated about this disease. And I started doing that 1 month after I was diagnosed. And when I got my run sheet in, I want to say November or December, I saw a name on it as, I believe it, your husband's name is John. I believe it was Jelena and John Tompkins. And then it basically, you know, had a Colorado address. And I was instantly like, I'm watching her YouTube videos and I just got sent a gratitude. Like, what a way to like pay it forward. So, I decided when I was going to do the gratitude, charity thing for CRC that I always was going to include a personal touch about myself, where I was at on my treatment at that moment. So, you know, it opened with I'm getting chemo radiation, to I'm having my first surgery, to I'm having my reversal. And I don't remember where I was at in my phase, but it was obviously early on, and I'm thinking you might still have that postcard, but, I decided to basically write to Jelena and thank her for already being a guide to me. And since I mentioned not being on social media, I figured I'd throw out my email address and find a way to connect with her. And the rest is kind of history. So it's over a year later, and I'm still doing that for them, and hope to do more in the future.
Yeah. Awesome. So yes, I do still have the postcard, and yeah, I wrote to you. I was like, oh my gosh, that's so awesome that like whoever is writing these happened to actually see my video. So yeah, I wrote to you, and we've been emailing back and forth ever since. Well, I hope, since I also am a runner, I've got my little metal plaque back here. One day, hopefully, we can get together in one of the states that we'd like to check off of our list and do a race together and actually like meet in person. But in the meantime, like, thank you so much for taking the time to talk with me, to share your story with everyone, and talk about those differences that you experienced during your treatment, and hopefully, you know, give hope to some others out there that are kind of going through the same thing.
Thanks for having me, Jelena.
You're welcome.
If you enjoyed listening to Amy's story, I'd really appreciate it if you clicked on the like button below to let me know you enjoyed it, and so that YouTube will hopefully show it to more people. Then, to check out more interviews that I've done with other colorectal cancer survivors, click on that playlist right up here. Thank you for watching.